And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. My fellow citizens of the world, ask not what America will do for you, but what together we can do for the freedom of man.
Hi, I'm Pat Spear. As we learned in part one of this series, this photograph of the president's skull, initially interpreted to be the back of his head, was later interpreted to be his forehead. But why? Was the initial inspection an error? Or was the interpretation of this photograph changed for political purposes? To answer this, we must first look at the history of another of the president's wounds, his back wound. On the evening of the assassination, the president's body was flown to Bethesda Naval Hospital for an autopsy. Three doctors, Commander James J. Humes, Dr. J. Thornton Boswell, and Dr. Pierre Fink, performed the autopsy. During the autopsy, they found an entrance wound in the upper back, but no outlet. The FBI agents assigned to report on the autopsy left that night satisfied that the bullet striking the president in the back had fallen out. They wrote this up in their report. On the day after the autopsy, however, Dr. Humes, tasked with writing up the doctor's own report, called one of the Dallas emergency room doctors, Dr. Malcolm Perry, and discovered that the tracheotomy incision Humes had observed had been cut through a small throat wound. At this point, Dr. Humes changed his findings and concluded that the bullet creating the back wound had actually exited through the small throat wound. But the problem was he never inspected Kennedy's neck. He thought it was a tracheotomy. They never cut into the neck to see if there was a bullet path there. Dr. Humes had just assumed that the bullet exited the neck without ever inspecting the body. He immediately jumped to the conclusion that this was the exit for the bullet that entered the president's back. Due to the FBI's strange reluctance to read Humes' autopsy report, the FBI stuck to their own story and leaked to the press that the back bullet had fallen out. By January 1964, articles and books repeating the FBI's interpretation were everywhere. The Warren Commission, tasked with investigating Kennedy's murder, however, had other concerns. In its January 27, 1964 executive session, Chief Counsel J. Lee Rankin acknowledges that there are problems with the autopsy report. Chiefly, that the back wound in the drawing created at the autopsy is below the throat wound on the drawing. This would seem to contradict that the shot was fired from the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository, the alleged location of the sniper's nest. Rankin concludes by stating he would be seeking help from the doctors along these lines. On March 16th, Dr. Humes testifies before the Warren Commission. Alerted by Warren Commission counsel Arlen Specter that he will not be permitted to consult the autopsy photos before his testimony, Dr. Humes brings along three drawings of how he remembers the wounds. These drawings, created by a young Navy artist named Skip Rydberg, show the back wound above the throat wound. While acknowledging that the photos forbidden to him would help him in his testimony, Humes nevertheless insinuates that the drawings are fairly accurate and that he used the measurements taken at the autopsy to create them. This is obviously untrue. When Humes' measurement at the autopsy of 14 centimeters from the tip of the mastoid process to the back wound is added onto the drawing, it's clear that the head in the drawing is 50% larger than life. When one makes the head in the drawings normal-sized, however, then Humes' 14-centimeter measurement places the wound too low to be in line with a shot from the sniper's nest. One could only wonder if this distorted drawing was the help sought by Rankin. The evidence of this is his commendation letter, sent to the young artist by Captain John Stover, the superior to both Rydberg and Dr. Humes. In this letter, first published by researcher Barry Keane, Captain Stover confirms that the drawings were created without the use of measurements and from verbal descriptions only. Note that Stover, who'd attended the president's autopsy and had seen the president's body, never even implies that the drawings are accurate, and instead enthuses that they accurately depicted the situation required. Rydberg's drawings were not accurate and were never intended to be accurate. Even so, Arlen Specter, The commission counsel charged with establishing the number and trajectory of the shots had his own doubts. Internal Warren Commission memos released in the 1970s established that Spector suspected that the Rydberg drawings were inaccurate and begged the commission to let Dr. Humes, at the very least, look at the autopsy photos to establish their accuracy.
Someday, someone may compare the films with the artist's drawings and find a significant error which might substantially affect the essential testimony and the commission's conclusions.
After initially agreeing to this inspection, Chief Justice Warren inspected the photos himself and decided against letting Humes or any other doctor inspect these photos. In ordinary circumstances, autopsy photos are the property of the autopsy pathologist. Warren's denying Humes access to the autopsy materials he'd had created is highly suspect. Does Warren's explanation that this was done to protect the privacy of the Kennedy family really hold water? On May 24, 1964, the Warren Commission, with the help of the Secret Service and FBI, staged a reenactment of the assassination in Dealey Plaza. It was this reenactment that supposedly convinced Spector and the Commission that not only would a bullet striking Kennedy from behind in the location described in the autopsy report be likely to exit his throat, but proceed in a direct line and hit Governor Connally, sitting in front of Kennedy, in his armpit. This is the so-called single bullet theory. The location of the back wound used in the reenactment had been, according to the subsequent testimony of Secret Service Inspector Thomas Kelly, determined by looking at one of the drawings created by Dr. Humes for the Warren Commission. As this drawing placed the wound at the base of Kennedy's neck, and the photos of the reenactment show it to have been on Kennedy's back, Kelly is clearly mistaken. When one looks at the testimony of the FBI's Robert Frazier, taken moments after Kelly, one sees that Frazier remembers them using the measurements on the face sheet to establish the wound location. As we have shown, Frazier's recollection is more credible than Kelly's. This suggests the possibility that Spector and Kelly were misleading the commission. But about what? I have a hunch. In a 1967 article in the Saturday Evening Post, and then again in his 2000 book, Passion for Truth, Spector revealed that Kelly had a copy of an autopsy photo with him that day, and that he showed him this photo.
When Kelly and I were alone in the hotel room, he showed me a small picture of the back of a man's body with a bullet hole in the base of the neck just where the autopsy surgeons said Kennedy had been shot. I never mentioned it officially.
A drawing of this photo was published by the government in 1978 and it matches the photos found on the internet. As the location of the wound of this photo is at the location of the measurements on the face sheet and jointly demonstrate that the wound seen at the autopsy was on the back, it appears that Kelly and Spector were well aware that the wound location and the drawings created by Humes were incorrect. And yet they hid this from the commission. Signs that Spector knew all along that the drawings were inaccurate can be found in his subsequent descriptions of the photo. Notice how he stealthily avoids comparing it to the drawings. Eventually, Spector was to admit that the drawings he'd had created were inaccurate.
The sketches were a bit rough. If we had to do it all over again, and we knew those sketches would be reproduced in hundreds of books with more precision and so closely scrutinized, I would have opposed doing them.
In 1999, Arnold Spector visited the National Archives with Dr. J. Thornton Boswell, one of the doctors who performed Kennedy's autopsy. They re-inspected the back wound photo and compared it to the photos of Kennedy's throat wound. They still claim the back wound was higher than the throat wound. Let's take a look ourselves. We're here with our friend Mark to try to show the relationship between Kennedy's throat wound and back wound. The throat wound was midway between his sternal notch and his Adam's apple, roughly here. And as you can see, it's roughly in line with his shoulders. As you can tell by looking at the autopsy photos, the back wound was roughly in line with his shoulder, and it was several inches below the lines on the back of Kennedy's neck. So we're going to approximate to be right here. As you can see, the throat wound and the back wound are roughly on the same level. Now this is a flat trajectory, which would indicate a shot had come directly from behind Kennedy. Yet, the Warren Commission ruled that the shot came from the sniper's nest, 20 degrees above. As you can see, a 20 degree trajectory, roughly this angle, would not exit in the throat here. The last panel to inspect these photos, the HSCA Forensic Pathology Panel, made up of 9 top forensic pathologists, concluded not only that the back wound was 2 inches lower than as presented by the doctor's inspector to the Warren Commission, but that the back wound was slightly lower on the torso than the throat wound. They also confirmed that it was the Rydberg drawings and not the autopsy report that were in error by concluding a bullet wound 13.5 centimeters below the mastoid process would be well down on the back and not on the neck. This photo of the May 24, 1964 reenactment, published in the June 1, 1964 New York Times, confirms that a bullet fired from the presumed location of the sniper's nest and hitting Kennedy standing at the location of the back wound and hitting Connolly in the armpit would exit lower on Kennedy's body than his throat. After the reenactment, in a warehouse, Arnold Specter performed a comparison of his own. In this photo, published as Commission Exhibit 903 and available on now Senator Specter's website, Specter measures the trajectory from the sniper's nest against Kennedy's stand-in. Notice the worried look on his face. Well, a look at a photo withheld from the Warren Commission, taken from the opposite angle, explains why. Here, one can see that in order to get the wounds to align, Specter has had to lift the back wound to the base of the neck, above the mark on the stand-in's back, in the location of the wound in the Rydberg drawings. The very drawings he knew to be inaccurate. Specter drew testimony from the FBI's Lyndall Schoenfeld that the angle at the reenactment was close enough. That the commission itself was not concerned with accuracy is confirmed by the April 27th memo from Warren Commission Counsel Norman Redlich proposing that the reenactment take place. Perhaps Specter himself believed the reenactment had been close enough. After his appeals for precision in his memos, however, this is hard to accept. Thus, the accuracy of the Rydberg drawings became official dogma. In his June 4th testimony, Inspector Kelly slips up and mentions a shoulder wound. Whoops! Notice how Specter quickly corrects him and inserts that it is, in fact, a wound at the base of the neck.
The base of his neck!
Something both men knew, after looking at the photo of the back wound, to be untrue. A few weeks later, while proofreading a proposed chapter of the Warren Report, Warren Commissioner Gerald Ford, the future president, changed the back wound description to be a wound on the back of the neck. While Ford may have been misled by the drawings presented in evidence by Specter, others play along with Specter's single bullet theory even though they don't believe it.
Well, what difference did it make which bullet got Connolly?
Well, it don't make much difference, but they said that they believe, that the commission believed that the same bullet that hit Kennedy hit Connolly. Well, I don't believe it.
I don't either.
And so I couldn't sign it, and I said that Governor Connolly testified directly to the contrary, and I'm not going to approve of that.
When the Warren Report is finally published on September 24, 1964, it states simply that the wound is at the base of the back of the neck. Truth by committee had become a lie. We'll continue with our discussion of the president's ever-moving back wound in part 3 of our series.
The commission believed that the same bullet that hit Kennedy hit Connolly. Well, I don't believe it.
I don't either.
And so I couldn't sign it. And I said that Governor Connolly testified directly to the contrary, and I'm not going to approve of that.